a crime. Sheriff, don't take a slice of my pie.
The Gillard government has been overwhelmed by the shambolic Craig Thompson and Peter Slipper affairs, but tonight it's all about the budget. I'm Sandra Sully. Good evening and welcome to this 10 News budget special. Tonight, back in the black, but at a price. Wayne Swan promises a $1.5 billion surplus. To deliver, he punishes business and defence and rewards low-income earners. But we have a team of reporters standing by across the country, along with finance experts, on how the 2012 budget blueprint shapes up and what you're likely to get out of it. One of our economic commentators is Barefoot investor Scott Pape. He's online now from New York, taking your budget questions in our Facebook forum. You can find him at facebook.com/10news. We'd also love to get your thoughts on Twitter tonight, so just remember to use the hashtag #It's10News. And we'll get some of your views a little bit later and show them in tonight's bulletin. But let's get down to business with political editor Hugh Rimmington. He's in Canberra tonight. Hugh, the Treasurer was calling this a tough love budget even before he delivered it. Did the leaks prove true?
Well, Sandra, every single Treasurer claims their budget is tough, 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 even when they're doling out cash. This is Wayne Swan's fifth budget, but when he came to announce the critical word everyone was looking for, surplus, he did it with a little air of triumph.
This budget delivers a surplus this coming year, on time, as promised, and surpluses each year after that, strengthening over time. Yeah. The deficit years of the global recession are behind us. The surplus years are here.
Well, to get to that $1.5 billion surplus that he's promising, the government had to find $17 billion in net savings. Now, it found nearly half of that, in fact, just over half of that, from two sources. Defence loses $5.5 billion and the foreign aid budget is stripped of nearly $3 billion. Now, the Treasury forecasts are important. They say unemployment will rise over the next 12 months up to 5.5%, growth climbing back to about 3.25%. Inflation, though, also expected to rise. That's a number the Reserve Bank will be watching. The budget allows for $1 billion towards a national disability insurance scheme that's been long awaited. Most of the money, though, is into the outlying years. Very little coming out over the course of the next year. And business is also another group waiting. You might recall that the mining tax carried as part of the package a 1% cut to business taxes. Now, Wayne Swan has tonight broken that promise and he's blaming Tony Abbott. The Coalition and the Greens both have opposed all or part of those business tax cuts, so now the government has taken that offer off the table.
I never thought we'd see the party of Menzies stand up in the Parliament and say, oh, no, we're not going to cut company tax.
So now Wayne Swan is going to spend that money from the mining tax and calling it spending the benefits of the boom. That's what this budget, he says, is all about. So more than $2 billion goes to these school kids bonuses, cash handouts to low and moderate income families with school-aged children. There'll also be $1.8 billion going in the form of extra family payments, up to $600 a year each for low-income families. They'll get that cash in July of next year. There's a little bit more for people on the dole. It works out to being about $4 a week. There's a bit more for some students and also for parents on income support. The wealthy, however, get hit. Superannuation concessions, tax concessions for people earning over $300,000, as was previously leaked, that will be cut. Living away from home allowances, executives like those, they're being cracked down on, and so are tax breaks on golden handshakes. Truckies also get hit. The heavy vehicle road users charge is going to be increased. Overseas travellers cop it. Bye-bye to those wonderful concessions on duty-free cigarettes. You'll only be allowed two packets of smokes from now on. The departure tax is also going up. And if you're drawing benefits, if you're away from Australia for more than 6 weeks, you will face a cut. Now, what of the surplus itself? Can those forecasts be believed? This year's deficit blew out from the predicted $22 billion to more than twice that number, $44 billion when the final figures came in. It plainly wouldn't take much to blow a $1.5 billion surplus out of the water.
Unexpected things can happen in national and international economies.
I mean, no one predicted or forecast the biggest natural disaster in our history, nor was it possible.
So there you have it. It's a knife-edge surplus. We're not going to know the real figures, whether this forecast can be reached, until about a year from now. What do you know? Just about in time for the next election. This is a political budget, Sandra.
It is indeed. Plenty of detail there. Thanks, Hugh. Let's get back to you again shortly. But now, how has the budget been received tonight? There's plenty of carrot and stick. Let's go to our National Affairs editor, Paul Bongiorno. Paul, this is Wayne Swan's fifth budget. What do you give it? And do interest groups tonight agree?
Well, Sandra, I'd give it a thumbs up for delivering a budget surplus. Of course, there are big questions, as we saw from Hugh, in the way he's going to deliver it and whether in the end it turns out being a pipe dream. The biggest broken promise, of course, the ditching of the business tax cuts and the directing of those funds to families and lower income workers. Well, business hates it.
The government has abandoned its promise to implement the corporate tax cut. We have the mining tax now legislated, and unfortunately the business community has been snookered by the politics of the parliament and the politics of the government.
This is a budget that is about more about take than give for business. The decisions around corporate tax rates are very disappointing. This is a long-held promise of the government to initiate corporate tax reform. We've seen none of that tonight in the budget.
Tonight, businesses have the right to feel hard done by this government.
And the Treasurer says, well, his budget is a budget for battlers, but not all welfare agencies agree. Disappointed that single parents will lose benefits and that the unemployed are kept below the poverty line. And the public sector union is warning that services will be cut because of job losses.
4,200 jobs are going across the public sector, and that will hurt services that every Australian relies on. Families and pensioners will see longer queues at Centrelink and Medicare.
You don't help people find work by forcing them into poverty. And you don't build a surplus on the backs of those who are already doing it tough.
From the perspective of the community sector, this is a fair budget. It's delivered for low-wage Australians. We welcome the investment in aged care reform, the National Disability Insurance Scheme, and a significant spend on public dental health care.
And there was very harsh criticism for slashing the foreign aid budget by $2.9 billion.
There are casualties to the government's broken promise on overseas aid spending. Most obviously, the casualties of people living in poverty throughout our region.
And the ACTU, it welcomes this budget, but it has some advice for the government.
We also warn that the government should be prepared, we think, to revisit the imperative to have a surplus budget should the economy in any way change due to the volatility in the global markets.
Well, some advice there. Well, I suppose if you measure a tough budget by the loudness of the criticism, Wayne Swan has delivered tonight.
So far, so good, Paul. Thank you. But let's check in with our finance reporter, Jackie Maddox. She's here and she has the latest from The Economist. Jackie, how are they rating tonight's blueprint?
Well, getting the budget back into black is always going to play well with economists because essentially it represents good economic management. Let's speak to economist Shane Oliver now from AMP. Good evening, Shane. This is the fourth straight deficit. This is the first surplus that we're going to see after four deficits. Is this the Treasurer delivering or making good on a political promise, or is it making good sense?
I think there's no doubt there's some politics to this, but I think it also makes great sense. This is about putting money aside for a rainy day. The global backdrop is still very uncertain. At some point in time, the government might have to implement another stimulus plan. So this provides scope to do that. By taking us back into surplus, we're putting money aside for a rainy day.
Is that going to mean more rate cuts, as the Treasurer claims?
I think we will see more rate cuts from the Reserve. Of course, the move back to surplus is not the only factor driving that, but the move to surplus is taking $46 billion out of the economy. So that will be a bit of a drag on growth. That will in turn provide scope for more rate cuts from the Reserve Bank.
OK, now it's difficult to imagine a government being less popular with corporate Australia. Already that cut to the company tax rate, it's not going down well, is it?
This is a bad night for big business. they were looking forward to a cut in the corporate tax rate. That's not going to occur, so that's certainly a bad thing for them. And, of course, they're not happy with that, and that's understandable.
OK. Now, very quickly, if you had to rate this budget, possibly Wayne Swan's last, what would you give it out of 10 and why?
I would have to say I'd give it a thumbs up. I'd give it 8 out of 10. Bottom line is this budget was all about a return to surplus. The government has done that, and that has to be a great thing. I reckon the rest of the world is looking upon us with envy. We're one of the few countries heading back into surplus.
Fantastic. Shane Oliver from AMP, thank you so much for joining us. Now, we're not expecting much reaction on financial markets tomorrow, and given all the upheaval in Europe, our economy really is the envy of the developed world. It's worth noting, too, that if we do see the economy return to surplus, we will be the first of the developed nations to do so since the GFC.
All right, thanks, Jackie. Well, what about you at home? Let's check in now with the barefoot investor, Scott Pape. He's in New York. Scott, our forum questions tonight are coming in thick and fast. So what's concerning people most about tonight's budget?
Well, I think lower income earners have done very well, but middle income earners have basically been left out of this. What we've seen also is higher income earners have been hit with a doubling of their contributions tax. And in what I think is a balanced budget, what we've got is smokers have been hit. You can no longer get those 200 cigarettes down to 50. But on the other side, you've got natural health remedy crackdowns by the government. So the healthy and the unhealthy are losing out in this one.
There's always two sides to this equation. The punters, of course, I want your view. Do you think they'll be happy? And secondly, the rich will whinge because they've been hit hard here. But if so much is coming out of the economy, I guess big business has to pick up the slack. Do you think they will?
Yeah, what we've seen obviously is the business tax cuts have been diverted to lower income earners. What we'll see though is with the coming carbon tax, how that actually plays out for the lower income earners. That's what Wayne Swan has structured this budget around. But there's not a lot in there for middle income earners, and I think that is what we're going to be seeing over the next few days.
Okay, thanks, Scott. We'll talk to you again a bit later. But if you have a question, join our Facebook forum. It's facebook.com/10news. Scott's online now for us, as you can see. He's also going to be taking a look at some of the Twitter questions coming through. Just remember to use the hashtag #It's10news. Next up, we focus on families and what all these numbers mean if you run a small business.